man, movie man, saying whatever a critic can. Sometimes wrong, sometimes right. We know he dislikes Twilight. Look out! Here comes the movie man. Welcome to the Final Cut, my friends, the show that never ends. So glad you could attend as we take a look at The Amazing Spider-Man. Got to see the midnight showing last night, about as early as you can get here in Cow Hump, Wisconsin. And this time around, we've got Andrew Garfield playing the title role Spider-Man, a.k.a. Peter Parker. And he's got a love interest, only this time in the form of Gwen Stacy, who is played beautifully by the beautiful Emma Stone. And the villain he fights in this is the Lizard, a.k.a. Dr. Kurt Connors, played magnificently by Rhys Ifans. Rounding out the cast, we've got Dennis Leary keeping his language PG-13 as Captain Stacy, the police captain hunting down Spider-Man and also protecting his daughter, Gwen, from the clutches of Peter Parker. And rounding out the cast, Martin Sheen as Uncle Ben with Sally Field as Aunt May. Two fantastic casting calls there. Folks, The Amazing Spider-Man is a film that stands well on its own two feet. It is a reboot of the franchise, yet it is a film that does not take away anything from Spider-Man, okay, directed by Sam Raimi. Both films stand well on their own two feet, and this film does not do anything to really insult or take away anything from that first film. It does have some stronger points in this that were weak in the other film, but there too, it also is weaker in some points on this in The Amazing Spider-Man that was a little bit stronger in Spider-Man. Now, the strengths in here are Peter Parker, Gwen Stacy, fantastic relationship. Love the chemistry between Garfield and Stone, okay? They sell this relationship and they give this time to develop, which was really nice to see that they didn't quite do in the first one. And then if Gwen Stacy is on the same mental IQ level as Peter Parker, okay? She seems like a girl Peter would more fall for in high school, and just in general, you got great chemistry, great relationship building, and some time for that relationship to build, so you buy into it, and you feel it's stronger, I think, in The Amazing Spider-Man than you felt between Spider-Man, Peter Parker, and Mary Jane, okay, in the first one. So there's a lot more stronger bond there, feeling there, attachment there to those characters, okay? But maybe that's because they actually took a lot more time in The Amazing Spider-Man before they start spiding out, okay? We've got a lot more character development in this film than you did in the first one. First one kind of felt like you jumped pretty much into the whole Spider-Man thing. It's like, we know the story, boom, bite, there you go. Let's see him develop and handle his powers. Where in this one, they took a little more time, at least the way it seemed, to develop all the other characters, get you invested in the relationship between Peter and Gwen, get you invested in Uncle Ben a little more and Aunt May, and just in general took their time with it before they get to the meaty good Spidey stuff, you know? So I liked that part as well. You know, and having Martin Sheen and Sally Field in here, even though their small roles, was fantastic in casting, helped bring some really solid acting work to this film that had some newer comers in it. You know, director Mark Webb really hasn't done anything, and so he handled the scope of this film very well. It was well-paced, and the 3D, the way it was handled, was done beautifully for the most part as well, where he's swooping through the city and that, you really feel that, and it feels exhilarating, it feels like you're part of, you're actually swinging along with Spider-Man. Now, but the only thing that I thought was a little bit weak in the film was with the villain. I sympathized and felt great for the Kurt Connors character, but when it got to him being the Lizard, it was a little harder to buy, but I had the same problem with the Hulk and the fact that you've got a completely CGI character, okay? And he's a main CGI character, and he looks CGI. I'm sorry, they did well in some of the action shots with Spidey and fighting. Those were exhilarating, fantastic, and fun to watch, to be sure. Really felt like Spider-Man with the way he was using his webs and everything. But, you know, the Lizard guy still looked CGI for the most part. Whereas in the first Spider-Man, we had a villain who wore a costume like Spider-Man, but was practical. You know, they didn't go... I know he was CGI in some parts, but still, you know, it was real and right there. So it was a little bit easier to sell. And this one, in the shots that they had with the Lizard Man, it looked a little fake. And it just took me out of it a little bit and made me go, you know, really? You know, I understand they were going for a different type of villain. And I just would have liked to have seen that done a little bit better. But on the whole, The Amazing Spider-Man is definitely worth your time. Definitely worth seeing in 3D. And really is a great reboot. And I can't wait to see what the sequel brings. And yes, there is a scene near the end, so stay near through at least the first half of the credits to see another scene in there, because it is Marvel and they're gaining that reputation for that type of feel. 4.5 stubs for The Amazing Spider-Man. Not quite 5, only because I felt a little weak point there with the villain and Spider-Man, but for the most part, solid film, folks. Definitely go see it. And I love it that we're in just full swing in the summer movie season, and I can't wait to see what comes up next. And that'll about do it for us here till Final Cut. Till next time, keep that ticket stub.